Ms. Maryland Soul Force Politics, Episode 001.
I believe that we are waking up from the spell that those that profit from the fear cast so well. And good people of the earth now can tell there is no us in them if not now.
Hello and welcome to the inaugural edition of Ms. Maryland Soul Force Politics. I'm your host, Heather Mizeur. And with me today, I couldn't be more excited, one of my dearest friends, Grammy and Oscar award-winning rock star, Melissa Etheridge. What began as a friendship shared over a common love of politics between us blossomed into a deep spiritual partnership of shared insights and heartfelt practices that have awakened our highest selves. We share that journey with you here today, and while we go a little deep on the spiritual talk at the beginning, stick with us to the end for the celebrity gossip and inside stories you are dying to hear. Did you ever meet Donald Trump in your celebrity days before
he
decided to be...
Yes, you can't help but meet Donald Trump if you are a celebrity. It's true.
And now, our interview. Melissa, thank you so much for being with us today.
My pleasure, Heather.
I am blown away by the many ways that your fingerprints are all over this project that I am launching, not the least of which your generous offer to allow the use of What Happens Tomorrow to be some of the opening music here on our podcast. The words are just so remarkable.
Oh, I love how you've always related to that. And in the 8 years that I've known you, 8 years plus that I've known you and grown with you and just, you know, seen where our work has taken us and our hopes and desires and dreams. And what a pleasure to be sitting down and actually letting some other people listen in on our conversation. That's pretty fun.
I know, we've been doing it so secretly for so long.
I know, for so long we've had such great discussions, and now we're going to have them in front of people.
Oh goodness, well welcome to our podcast, everyone, our inaugural episode here on Ms. Maryland Soul Force Politics. And no better way to start each episode than with the words from that song, What Happens Tomorrow, that I believe that we are waking up from a spell that those who profit from the fear cast so well, and the good people of the earth now can tell, there is no us in them. Mm. And it's your dedication, Melissa, to this concept that there needs to be no division between us, no matter what our backgrounds and ideologies, that has been so profound in the shift in my own thinking as a political person, in embracing all sides and bringing everyone together. What brought you to this being your manifesto in life?
Wow. Well, that's a life's journey. And I would say it started actually with the happening of me having my dreams come true. There's nothing like having your dreams come true to really have you take a look at life, because one, they're not going to be what you really thought they would be, and you would think that they're going to solve all your problems and everything's going to be fine afterwards, and that doesn't exist either. There is always a contrast in life. And when I got to this point, it was about in 2003, I looked, I had had a big, my successes in the 90s were big. It was everything I ever wanted. I sang with Bruce Springsteen. I, you know, played Madison Square Garden. All those crazy dreams I had were coming true. I was a rock star. I had a relationship, and then I had a divorce, and then I had children, and I started getting kind of disillusioned about, wait a minute, this dream that I had, it's disappearing. It's becoming something else. And I was actually very kind of disillusioned with life. I looked around and went, well, wait a minute, without that drive, without that goal of, oh, I want this to be, you know, without putting something in front of me, I felt very lost. I felt like I was in a boat with no oars. And I kind of looked up to the universe, and I've never been a crazy religious person. I've always been around religion because I'm drawn to it. I am drawn to the spiritual aspect of life. You know, you gotta when you wake up and realize, oh, I'm a human being here on this Earth, which is a rock, you know, hurling through space, so it's fantastic speeds. And I am in this, you know, meat suit and skeletal, yet there's something in there, there's a spirit in there. And when I kind of realized that, I looked to the universe, which is what I call, you know, source. Source is pretty much, and you could put God, you can put whatever name you want there.
Creator.
I like to call it source. When I looked to source and said, what do I do now? What do I want? What's going on? Well, the next day, I actually woke up with a lump in my breast and went, wait a minute, what do you mean? You know, that's not what I was thinking yet. That experience of going through breast cancer really was the strong push into my spiritual journey. I mean, truly going into that. When you look at life and death, when you think, oh, this spark that's in me could be gone and I would be gone. Wait a minute, what does that mean? And it was the questions that I asked as I went into it and went into my treatment for that. I really closed off and I gave myself time to be still.
Isn't that so important?
And that's why I say my cancer was a gift, because it forced me to be still, and I had not been still for 43 years. And I laid there. I mean, it was complete stillness because the chemotherapy was called dose dense, and it was really, really, really heavy, and it brought me as close to death as they could take you, you know, this whole thing. And in that stillness, I could actually feel the different parts of me, that there's a spirit and there's a body, because my body was at zero, yet my spirit was still 100% and running, and I was like, this makes sense to me. And so I often tell people, when you're searching for spirit, the best thing to do is be still, find stillness. That's why meditation is so important. And stillness in nature, those things, super duper duper important.
Absolutely. It quiets that buzz around you and that mind activity, and really helps you get into a heart space, which is where spirit resides.
Absolutely. And I realized that our whole system is based on duality, based on the yin and yang, the two forces, that there's light and dark. And this is what I call duality. This is what most people call duality. And seeing that is the experience of life, the experiential aspect of life. It's what gives us life, is this contrast, is this light and dark, this night and day, this thought of good and bad. Understanding that my brain is even like that. I have a left side and I have a right side. I mean, I started reading everything. I read spiritual books, quantum physics. I read scientific books. I read history books. I read, you know, all religions. I studied up on every religion, because I started to get this fantastic idea and inspiration that it's all about the same thing. That it's, I mean, really, if you get down to the basics of everything, it's all about the same thing. And it comes down to this dualistic principle, that what I came away with was, wait a minute, there's a belief, and it's beliefs that hold things together. And that belief of us against them, that belief of I'm here and there's something outside of me that can affect me, that can cause harm to me, that's something out there. And that's really the basis of human existence right now. Most people believe that something out there could come and hurt me, whether it's the enemy, the unknown criminal, something I've done, God. You know, some people see God as a judging, that there's a judge out there that's judging me. And this, when you really dare to break through that belief, which is really, really off the charts of the way people think, really.
I know. I remember when you first started talking to me about this, and I thought you were crazy.
Yes.
And I just gave you dispensation. Well, she's my crazy rock star friend. Mm-hmm. But slowly and surely, it started to make more and more sense to me.
It is I tell people, when I don't try to preach this, and I certainly don't try to, you know, change anybody else because I can't. You know, this is, I tell people this is something that has to be learned. You can't teach it. And yet when people do come to me and ask me, like you did, we had many, over 8 years, we've had so many conversations, and you have actually been you've been my greatest teacher because you have asked me the questions that I needed to answer to find my answers, if that makes sense.
Wow. Thank you.
No, it's so true. That's the way it works. You will find that once you start on this journey, and this is a journey, this is a practice. Mm-hmm. You don't get this right the first day. It's not, oh, I got it. This is a practice, and the universe unfolds for you, and Source shows you, it lights up your way, and all of a sudden you're like, oh, wait a minute, can you believe that happened? And you have these coincidences that just, you know, that and pretty soon you can't call them coincidences. You see that there is actually a uniform way that this is laid out. If your belief can be lined up in such a way.
And how everything shifts when you stop buying into the illusion that there is something that separates us, that we are all connected to each other, even when we have differences of opinion. And that one of the things that I am so, so blessed that you ingrained in me early on in our friendship was that I had a choice in every circumstance to view something with either fear or love. And if I came at it from a heart space and I chose to hold something with love every single time, that there was magic in that. And I started to apply that to my politics. Mm-hmm. And how did two Midwestern girls who initially bonded over the fact that each of us carried around pocket constitutions when we were little kids.
And we adored John F. Kennedy. Indeed.
Oh, the Kennedys, the politics, the birth of this civic action inside of us, social justice, where we wanted to make a difference in the world, me through politics, you through your music, but mm-hmm. your music that is very political in nature many times. How did we get here, right?
How did we get here? Because that's where it leads us. Because I've always related to you because you do have the same sort of heart space of a true belief of the sacredness of the American experiment, the American ideal of democracy. And we are seeing it today. Everything that you and I have ever been talked about is now being played out on the world stage. And
in a big, big way.
In a huge, huge way. We are seeing, and it was surprising to a lot of us who think of ourselves as progressive or you know, liberal, and yes, we're making the world better and we're just going along. Yet we have made the mistake of believing that, well, there's we, and then there's them who think that, and they mm-hmm. and they need to be
educated. Only they understood it the way
they're
we
not,
did.
And they're so uneducated, and they're so not important, yet their fear is real. Absolutely. You go talk to anyone who either voted for Trump or believes it, because they have been, one, they've been fed this fear over our television waves. And it's you know, that fear has cells, and they believe it. So you cannot push against that. And that's one of the things I've always told you, is that we have an energy. We have a choice on how we're going to meet fear. If you can really break down between love and fear what something is and look at it and go, okay, am I saying this out of fear? Am I saying this out of love? And if you can just break everything down to that, that's how we start to dismantle and put back together a society. And it we are in the very beginning of it. This is the very beginning. And it's up to us. You, me, everyone who's listening to this now, everyone who is inspired, everyone who finds that you know, this pushing against them is not working. It's not working. They're, oh my God, they're in charge now. They are in charge. That fear is in charge. Mm-hmm. Wow, I can't fight against it because it draws me into that. I become mm-hmm. the darkness when I mm-hmm. push against the darkness. So I have to believe in my light. I have to believe, I have to stand here and create this one step at a time. And believe me, to someone who's not close to understanding it, it sounds like crazy talk, mm-hmm. and it's just a journey.
It's an absolute journey, and it makes sense that it takes stages to get there. And some of it has to do with privilege. I have a lot of privilege in my life that gives me the benefit to step back and look at some of this once removed, because I am not an immigrant family facing mm-hmm. deportation.
Yes.
I am not an African American who fears being profiled or yeah. being shot by the police. I am not a lot of things that we are all rising up in concern about where the world is and how people are being treated. And I recognize that. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, have to try to find that place in my heart that can look at President Trump mm-hmm. and understand the wounded boy mm-hmm. that is acting out on a very big stage with way too much power.
Yeah.
The pain and suffering that he has never learned to deal with about his own human experience. Mm-hmm. And it is definitely challenging in a desire to be a part of the resistance and definitely stand up against a dismantling of our healthcare system and to fight for a living wage and to stand up for our environment and the ridiculous building of all these pipelines mm-hmm. and overthrowing decisions about Standing Rock to Mrs. Obama's school lunch program for children. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of really ugly things that are happening out there. Mm-hmm. And I want to make it very clear that in this approach that we're discussing, we're not saying step back and let all that happen. Mm-hmm. Absolutely show up and yes. fight to make sure that our values are protected, but do it in a way that finds space to embrace the other.
It's the process of what we call fighting. It's the mindset of the fight. When you look and say, okay, yeah, the Standing Rock, this is so not okay to drill and put and then put, you know, pipelines under land that is sacred and can, you know, ruin, you know, lives of many people. Not okay. And pull back just a little bit and also see when you think you're in a choice of I have to push back or I'm going to lose, that's when, well, okay, if I'm feeling this, then I need to pull back and say, okay, how can I inside come to a conclusion, a thought, an understanding about this that turns it positive? And when I look at Dapple, I say, this is the last dying cry of an old, old system of energy, of oil, and it's going away. We are quickly, I mean, when you look at the headlines and you see Apple and Google and they're racing to find the first flying car, and this is all on electricity, and, you know, the Tesla is outselling Ford, you know, the Tesla, oil will be it won't be an issue mm-hmm. very soon. Mm-hmm. Then you can approach the Dapple and go, oh, poor guys, I know you're trying so hard, but in just a few years, in a few turns of the sun, you won't have the money to do this anyway. Mm-hmm. And your money's going to go. And they've been in charge for a long time. They, again, the mm-hmm. them that believe in this, and see this as the only form of money and that are in that belief, it's going to be a noisy change and a difficult one, but it is already coming. Solar, wind, electricity, these powers are here now. And because of the way America is, because the need, you know, supply and demand, it is our desire to have alternative energy that makes it win. That desire wins. Not pushing against the oil. The desire to have more is what drives us into the future.
I'm reminded almost on a daily basis that ever since November 8th, mm-hmm. 2016, almost every single day I see evidence of a massive awakening that is happening. And I also thank, in the same way that you embraced your cancer and thanked it for the gift that it is. This will sound counterintuitive to people who are listening, but there is a piece of me that is very thankful for what happened on that election day, because had Hillary Clinton won, I know I can speak for myself. I was very comfortable with a semi-retired life on my farm, having felt that I had contributed my pound of flesh to the public sphere and was kind of living a private life. And after the election, I said, oh, goodness, there's so much more work to be done. And we can't be on the sidelines anymore. We have to step forward. And to the extent that what happened on that election cycle forced me off the sidelines again to come forward and really say, okay, what is needed right now? And for my gift through Ms. Maryland and Soul Force Politics to emerge, that's just one thing. That's just me. I'm one piece of sand on the beach. I know so many people around me who are doing the same thing, that are calling their members of Congress when they never were engaged before, had never done a constituent meeting, are turning out to town halls, that are informing themselves about the issues. Are you seeing that in your world as well?
Just think, truly, in 2 years, how much more involved and, as the kids say now, woke.
Yeah.
Can you believe that that's a thing now?
That's a hashtag now.
It's a woke, you know? That's because they get it. That generation, the younger generation, gets that there's more here to wake up to. Can you imagine 2 years, in 2 years, how much more involved, educated, inspired we as an American people and the world will be because he was elected president. And that's when you can look at what looks like the worst thing that could ever happen, when you can look at it with gratitude, now you're playing the game.
And that is forever something I will always thank you for, dear friend. You helped me embrace my election loss as a beautiful thing and a journey and something that I could learn from when I wanted to be very upset.
I know.
Didn't let me be upset about it.
Well, I held you for a moment and we cried a little and then we went past it. But to have gratitude, and it's key. I tell people every day, I speak to people with cancer all the time. I speak to people who, you know, who are gay and don't know how to do it. If you can fill your life, your heart, your space, your world with gratitude, that is the bottom line, the best medicine, best medicine. And I mean, even if you look and you say, I have nothing to be grateful for, man, you start small. You say, I am grateful for my socks. You know, I am grateful for this table. And you move from there because gratitude, you feel gratitude is medicine. And then when you come to these big, huge things, you're like, all right, man, it doesn't feel right, but I am grateful for Donald Trump. And I had to say that. Believe me, November 9th, I was walking around, I'm grateful for Donald Trump. I'm grateful I can do this. Like, oh my God, I have to listen to my own medicine. I can do this. I believe this. I believe, and I have seen it unfold. And I saw it the day after that inauguration. That was what I went, that's what it's about. Because I saw that we, all over the whole world, all over the world, that's who we are. That we are coming out. That many people, millions of people can come peacefully, can come out and say, no, we're moving on. That the female aspect, and really, I pull out further and further away to examine something. And when you really look at what's happening in our world right now, it is the balance, the feminine balance, trying to come into balance. We are looking for balance. And the yin, the feminine, has been out of balance for 2,000 years.
And what I think is a misnomer sometimes when there's discussion about this, the yin, the feminine, isn't trying to rise up to replace the yang. To truly be in balance is to have them both there. For too long, it's just been the yang approach. And when we bring this feminine energy forward, it's to embrace the yang, to create that yielding, that big mother bear hug of nurturing to the world.
It is the ultimate definition of duality. is there is duality. We are in a dualistic reality. There's male, female. There's light, dark, left, right, whatever. There's good, bad, whatever. And that is what makes us be able to experience everything. Otherwise, it would just be all one thing. Mm-hmm. And this great diversity is what gives us power to move forward and create that balance.
Well, and on the political stage, we saw this playing out recently with Senator Warren and her speech raising concerns about Jeff Sessions being the Attorney General based on a letter from Coretta Scott King. And most of our listeners will be familiar with that famous, and yet she persisted moment from Senator Mitch McConnell. I know you recently had an opportunity to meet Senator Warren. I'm sure that that was an
amazing person, wonderful woman. I mean, you know, there's so many just great women who have, you know, dedicated their life to service in politics, and they are shining examples.
But that moment on the Senate floor when Mitch McConnell couldn't believe that he couldn't use the rules of the Senate and his force of his young energy to quiet her. I love the internet is amazing, if for nothing else than the hashtags and the conversations that occur about these moments that come forward, that women are going to rise up and have a voice.
Yeah. Well, make no mistake that is what everything is based in. What we're going through right now is about the female force coming onto the stage, it coming into balance. Mm-hmm. And that's throwing all the hierarchical archetype of this patriarchy, you know, how everything has been done from business to leadership is crumbling. And that's really scary to some people. And that's why we kind of find ourselves in this position.
Mm-hmm. Did you ever meet Donald Trump in your celebrity days before he decided to be?
Yes, you can't help but meet Donald Trump if you are a celebrity. It's true. I met him many times. Once I was at the Time 100 dinner. I was, after cancer, I was on the Time 100 list, and I was sat at this most incredible table. It was myself. It was the head of Time Warner. It was Jon Stewart. It was Martha Stewart when she was under house arrest, and so she had to leave before my performance because her little
ankle bracelet was going to
go off. Yes. So when she showed me her ankle bracelet, so I think that's pretty amazing. And then Donald Trump was there, just in his Donald Trumpness. Steve Jobs met him and his wife, and so that was an amazing night. Then I met him. I would say this was 5 years ago, 4 years ago, at a gay wedding. A wedding of Steve Ross, is a huge real estate guy in New York City, and his son Roth,
Jordan
Roth. Thank you, Jordan Roth was getting married. He's gay, getting married, beautiful. It was like a big New York high society wedding, and there was Donald Trump, you know, celebrating with all his gaybies, and you know, so to hear him come out against the LGBT is like, oh, come on,
yeah. In mentioning the Time 100 dinner after you had cancer, I was reminded about one of your iconic performances when you came out on stage to sing the Janis Joplin song and didn't have any hair.
Bald.
But also, I know, physically weak, but no one would ever have known it from the performance that you turned in that night. Tell us a little bit about
that. Well, this is one of those examples of fear. And when I was diagnosed with cancer, of course, there was a lot of fear going on. And I had just started this, I'd only been like a year into this, you know, wait a minute, what's really life and what's going on and fear. And so it really put me on the, okay, if you believe this, are we going to go this road? Are you going to believe in death? Are you going to believe that this can actually be a gift? And I, you know, like I said, I was down there in it every day in the chemotherapy, really being still, really meditating and reading and praying, as it were, you know, in a way, and spiritually really connecting. And then I received a call that said, hey, you know, because I'd been nominated for a Grammy, and they asked if I would do a tribute to Janis Joplin, and I thought, oh my God, and I was just in bed sick, you know, and I thought, God, how can, you know, can I do this? Can I, I'm all ashy, I'm bald, you know, and so everything inside me is like, no, I don't want the world to see me like this. And I thought, wait a minute, this is what it's about. This is exactly what the fear is about. If I can change the dialogue, if I can change the belief, the held belief that, oh, that baldness is the worst thing about, you know, chemotherapy treatment, that the worst thing about cancer is that you're going to be bald. It's like, no, it's not. No, it's not. Baldness, my hair does not define me.
That's right.
And taking that belief and then going, okay, I'm going to stand up. And I went to my radiation appointment. I got in the car. I drove to the Grammys.
Wow.
So I was very tired. I sat in the audience for a little bit. I went through it was my first time back out in public, and it was beautiful. It was a wonderful experience. Most of it was great. And I got up and performed, and then I went home and went back to bed. And I did it for me.
Where was that reserve of energy that you tapped into, though? Because you were clearly channeling some other source when you were singing that song. It was like, I can't imagine what it would have been like to watch it live, but anyone who just goes and searches it on YouTube and watches a video clip of it, you can't watch it without getting goosebumps. You're channeling something else there. But each time I tell myself that I think I've had enough, oh, I'm gonna show you, baby, a woman can be tough. I want you to
Well, I think that's a lot, that probably is a testament to being so clear. I had been so clear. I'd been for almost 3 months, I'd been away and really focused. I came very, very humble, very, very clear, and stood there. And where usually my energy might be sort of everywhere and you know, running around the stage or something, I just stood there in one place and focused all my energy in the singing. So to me, it's a really low energy performance, but because of that, it translates on television really powerfully. Mm-hmm. And so it was kind of perfect for that. And I swear, not a week goes by that someone still doesn't say, and that was 12 years ago.
Yeah.
That someone still doesn't say something that it meant so much to them. Or one of my favorite, I just want to tell you a little story. One of my favorite things was a few years ago, I was in a bookstore, and I saw a man, he was standing asking information on a book, and what I assume was his daughter, was in a wheelchair next to him, and she was probably 8, 9 years old, and she was bald, and she had that look of someone going through what I know to be, you know, chemotherapy. And she kind of looked up at me with those hollow eyes and with that sort of, you know, with that scared chemo thing. And I looked at her and I was just drawn to her, and her father was facing the other way. And I just, you know, I looked at her and I just smiled, and, you know, she acknowledged me, and her father kind of turned around and looked and reached down, and he said, "Celia, honey, remember that video I showed you? This is the woman who sang on stage, you know?" And just to think that people are showing children, mm-hmm, "Oh, see this woman, she went through what you did too, and she was bald, and she came out.
And she's okay."
And that, just to know that I can give that something that I did, mm-hmm, for myself, to stand up and say, I am not a victim here. Mm-hmm. I am not. I'm not even battling this. I am concentrating on my health, and I am understanding what health is. That when we do that, and that is what this whole thing is about, when we stand up in our own strength, not against anything, but in our own strength, that is when we inspire the most.
Oh, I love you so much.
I love you too, sweetheart.
12 years ago, well, 20 years ago, we all are celebrating about this time the famous Ellen coming out episode.
I know, I just went through all that. 20 years, man.
No kidding, right?
Mm-hmm.
What a changed world we live in. I mean, what was it like for you? Like, you were out already, and mm-hmm. that's what made it so beautiful, you handing Ellen the toaster. And of course, half the world didn't get it because they didn't understand our joke about getting a toaster when you come out as a lesbian. But such a beautiful moment in television history. But and again, another one of those moments that really, really changed the world, and you were right there in the middle of it.
It was, the 90s were a wonderful time of change, wonderful time of Clinton and Gore being in office, of Clinton being the first president to even say gay and lesbian, you know, those words never even came out of another president's mouth. And to be acknowledged as part of the fabric of America empowered so many, and then the Hollywood community, the community that creates the work that mirrors our society, the movies, the TV shows, the music, so important because that's what reaches the youth. And now those that were in their teens in the 90s are now full grown, running it, fully grown adults who are living amazing lives and doing wonderful things. And that's how this works. What we think of now is, oh my gosh, this is awful. The changes, the choices we are making today inspires, you know, my children are 10 years old, 18, 20, and this inspires them. And when they, in 20 years, you know, it'll be different things, but they will know that this is the way we move forward as society, is by confronting these fears and moving through them, not pushing against them, moving through them and finding the answer on the other side.
Mm. You mentioned Al Gore, and you won an Oscar for a song he asked you to write for his movie, Inconvenient Truth. He's pushing a sequel that I'm very excited to see sometime soon.
Yeah.
He really changed the consciousness of the concern for climate change across the world through that film. Talk a little bit about your involvement in that with him.
Well, again, here is a man who went through a crushing defeat and would be totally understandable if he hung it up and went, oh, well, Supreme Court, are you kidding me? You know, forget it. I was stolen. He could have been bitter. He could have done all kinds of things. Yet you see his heart. And he was always known as, I remember when he was running for president, they're like, oh my God, just don't get him talking about the environment. He'll sit you down for 4 hours. He'll bore you to death. You know, it was known that his passion was for this earth, for this environment. And what he did was he threw himself into that work afterwards. He believed in it so much, and it was from that that they then created this slideshow. And when he called me and said, "Hey, I'm doing a slideshow. You wanna do some music for it?" I thought, "Oh, it'll be in some high schools or something." And this is a sweet little thing that Al Gore has asked me to do. I had no idea this was going to be a major film release. And you know, then Paramount came on, and they really participant media. And they really, you know, said, hey, this has a chance. And they put a good advertising campaign behind it and a marketing campaign. And they, when that hit in the summertime, once again, I was humbled by the ability for people to change, for them to change their beliefs, because that's all that happens, is a belief changes. And you can go in and we can criticize what's happened. You know, you can criticize anything. But to actually see the positive aspect of this, and again, that was 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. And, you know, those things are in danger now. Mm-hmm. And yet it's with fearlessness that we move ahead, because we know that partnership with our earth that gives us life is that understanding of how that's part of a chain of this whole existence that we have, and the respect for that, that's only growing.
In reverberating in so many unexpected ways, mm-hmm. one of the big environmental issues that I have engaged on in Maryland throughout my legislative career, and even in the last couple of years just as a citizen activist, was to make sure that Maryland never set a drill in the ground to do fracking. And
I saw that.
We had the most unexpected victory this year when our Republican governor came forward to join forces with us and say, I'm going to sign this bill into law, pass it. Could have knocked us over with a feather. I mean, I never thought he was going to come to our side on that.
And I saw that. I meant to actually call you and say, oh my gosh, congratulations. I couldn't believe it. I thought you were behind it. But when he just, see, you never know when someone, you can't say, well, he's a them, so he's not going to do that. Mm-hmm. People have their minds. People have hearts and spirits. And if you believe in the inherent goodness in everyone, that we have that, then you can visualize and expect good things to happen.
Mm-hmm.
I was so happy about that.
I was thrilled beyond measure, and actually am excited that Governor Hogan is going to guest on our podcast series, and we're going to go into depth conversation about his change of heart and his joining forces with us on fracking and a number of other issues
that he's
been
that.
Very, very open to engaging with us on eliminating this us versus them approach.
That is leadership. That is, you tell him I said that's leadership.
Well, he wants to meet you when you come to Maryland.
Oh.
Well, Melissa, I can't begin to thank you for your years of mentorship, friendship, spiritual guidance, an amazing library of music that feeds me regularly, and so many people that I know who are just incredible fans. You are a gift to the world.
Well, thank you, Heather. I appreciate you. I appreciate what you're doing here. I appreciate your path, how you went through what you went through and have changed it, and you have walked through and come out with this beautiful way to reach people, to explain that this is a journey, that we're just taking this step by step, that it's a practice, that every day, if you just see everything as a choice between love and fear, just start there and work through and read and listen and be open. I just love what you're doing. This is a great place for people to come and feel and be fed that soul revolution, that soul politics, that soul force. I love it. So thank you so very much. I want to do this again sometime.
I'm going to hold you to that.
Right on. Amen. I'm there, sister. I'm there.
All right. Blessings.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I believe if I look hard enough, I will see that there can be enough. And I believe I can think clear enough to conceive a place where there's enough. If not,
and that wraps up for us this inaugural edition of Ms. Maryland, Soul Force Politics. Ms. Maryland is a fire starter for social justice warriors. Soul Force Politics is a new movement of people willing to cast aside the warning labels that caution us against blending our politics with our spirituality.
I believe a woman can work hard and succeed, and we could be content to believe that she could be in charge of the free and be the president. If not now,
our spirit empowers us, our spirit connects us, and it stokes the passions of our hearts. Our political discourse desperately needs the guidance, strength, and clarity of our soul's force for good in the world. Inner wisdom plus external actions, that's Soul Force Politics. You have found your tribe. We will feed your fire. To join our community and never miss an episode by subscribing to this podcast on your favorite podcasting application and visiting our website at www.MizMaryland.org. Next week, tune in for an in-depth conversation that spans the career of one of Maryland's most beloved figures, U.S. Senator Barbara Mikulski, in what is her first ever recorded podcast.
And good people of the earth now can tell there is no us in them, if not now.
I'm Heather Mizeur, encouraging you to be the change you want to see. Create the world you want to manifest. Break through the illusions of impossibility. Live your life's purpose with clarity, intention, and truth. Choose only love and be one. For the people.